Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. I am so excited that next month is Nonfiction November, a booktube event put together by the amazing Olive from the channel A Book Olive. Today, I want to put forward my TBR. I have a couple of additional nonfiction reading commitments for the month, including a buddy read I'm very excited about of a book I've been meaning to read for a while. But today, I'm going to give you my answers to the four brilliant prompts that Olive has come up with this year. I love her prompt style. She throws out four individual words, all of which can be interpreted in so many different ways. If you are putting together your TBR, you don't really have to use her prompts at all. But these prompts aren't designed to get you to read particular kinds of books as much as to play the game of fitting what you want to read in November to the incredibly open words. Give it a try. It also makes watching other people's TBRs so much fun. Well, this year, all of the books I am going to name are books about books, some older and some that will be published during the month of November. To be honest, there are more books on this list than I will probably be able to get to, so these are really a pile of possibilities rather than a strict plan. Let's get started. The first prompt is collection. I was thrilled to see that Olive listed the forthcoming book, The Library, A Fragile History, by Andrew Pettigrew. My choices for this prompt are kind of adjacent, not about libraries per se, but about collecting and selling old and new books. Recently, I saw the wonderful and fairly new documentary called The Booksellers, a wide-ranging exploration of people who love old books, collecting them, and selling them. There are stories about people who collect everything from beautifully bound leather sets of classic authors to people who put together collections about the early days of hip-hop. If you're a book lover and you get a chance to watch this documentary, do give it a try. I'll link to the website, which I believe gives you a variety of online sites where you can watch it. Anyway, one of the parts of the film I loved most, out of a lot of really wonderful segments, was a discussion of two women who became very important collectors in the United States at the time when there were almost no women at the top of the field. They were Leona Rostenberg and Madeleine Stern, sometimes referred to as the Holmes and Watson of the bookish world because they tracked down the story of what Louisa May Alcott wrote under a pseudonym. I was absolutely thrilled to find out that the two of them had penned a book about their experiences, a book called Old Books, Rare Friends, Two Literary Sleuths and Their Shared Passion. I can't wait to dip into this volume. The next book I'd like to read for this prompt collection is Sylvia Beach's book, Shakespeare and Company. This book is her own account of starting the English language bookstore in Paris that became something of a hub for American expats such as Gertrude Stein, Ernest Hemingway, and F. Scott Fitzgerald. She also published Ulysses by James Joyce and brought it to an international audience, only to be shunned by the author later. She talks about her connection with D.H. Lawrence and T.S. Eliot, Ezra Pound, Thornton Wilder, and other authors coming to the forefront in the interwar years. Although there are a few scholarly works on Sylvia Beach, which I'm eager to read at some point, starting with her own telling seems perfect. And finally for this prompt word, I want to mention a forthcoming book called The Last Bookseller, A Life in the Rare Book Trade by Gary Goodman, due out on November 30th. This is another first-person account of collecting and selling books. The success of Goodman's store inspired so many other bookshops to open in his small town of Stillwater, Minnesota, that Richard Booth, founder of the Booktown movement in Hay-on-Wye, named Goodwin's town the first booktown in North America. This book recounts the early struggles in the book trade, his experiences at estate sales and book fairs, some of his memorable finds, and many of the book lovers and collectors from all over the world whom he met along the way, including a few book forgers and thieves. Throughout his years in the book business, Goodman experienced massive changes in the industry, from the rise of chain bookstores to their replacement with online venues. The development of the internet made stores like his all but obsolete. Although his book town supported nearly 50 secondhand bookshops in the 1990s, today Stillwater supports fewer than 10. This sounds like a quirky book at some spots and a heartbreaking one at others. Okay, on to the next prompt word, style. For this word, I want to look at how various editors styled the books they worked on. Style works in several ways here. The particular style that editors have as they work with individual authors, how they edit the styles of the writers they're about to publish, and depending on the level of the editor, how they build a style for the entire publishing house. The first book I want to look at here is Max Perkins, Editor of Genius by A. Scott Berg. Although I have not read this book, I have seen a film adaptation, the movie Genius, starring my beloved Colin Firth as Max Perkins and the wonderful Jude Law as Thomas Wolfe. Neither are exactly obvious choices for these very American people, but both actors turn in phenomenal performances, not surprisingly. I gather that the book looks at a broader story, not focused quite as exclusively on the relationship between Perkins and Wolfe, but really considering his work with both Fitzgerald, Hemingway, and even writers like Marjorie Kennan Rawlings, etc. It's also about his role as father and his spouse and lover. I can't wait to read this, and I can't quite believe I've left it on my shelf unread as long as I have. My second book in the style category is A Bite of the Apple, A Life with Books, Writers, and Virago by Lennie Goodings, published last autumn. This is part memoir, part history of Virago Press. Virago was founded in the early 1970s with the explicitly feminist goal of supporting both women editors and women authors. The press has been publishing contemporary work by writers like Margaret Atwood, Marilynne Robinson, Sarah Waters, Naomi Wolf, Maya Angelou, many others. Virago also has brought back into circulation a huge number of earlier writings by women under their modern classics insignia. I am very excited to read this book, but from what I hear, I'm going to finish it with an enormous list of books, having just been added to my long-term TBR. Finally, for this prompt, I want to mention a little book about editing, with a rather strange style of its own, Tales of the Pen Master, Zen Stories for Editors, Writers, and Other Publishing Professionals, by the editor Jack Lyon. This book was published in November, a couple of years ago. Let me just read one passage to give you a taste. A typesetter impatiently asked the pen master, "Will our esteemed designer ever reach enlightenment?" The master looked up from reviewing the publishing schedule. "She's waiting on the editor." "And when will the editor reach enlightenment?" "He's waiting on the designer." As is customary in Zen tradition, apparently, each tale is followed by commentary. As the author writes, "I hope the stories are entertaining, but they shouldn't be just gulped down like pieces of popcorn. Take time to ponder each one, and you may yet become enlightened in the pathways of publishing." Okay, on to the third prompt word, treatment. And for this one, I want to think about how books are treated after their publication, especially by critics and book reviewers. The first book I want to look at is one I've actually read before, but I read it at a time when I had not yet really written book reviews myself. The book is Inside the Critic's Circle, Book Reviewing in Uncertain Times by Phillipa K. Chong. I've been thinking about this more again after reading a set of essays about reviewing that were published recently, and when I talk about Chong's book, I'll try to remember to talk about those essays as well. Essentially, Chong is writing a book with a very academic style about the potential conflicts and difficulties that the reviewing industry faces. The second and somewhat related book for the prompt is Beyond the Blurb, on Critics and Criticism by Daniel Green. It's a selection of essays that identifies and tries to define the most important principles of literary criticism, partly by looking at how specific literary critics, including James Wood, Harold Bloom, Susan Sontag, put those principles into action. From what I've heard, this book is both smart and snarky, with a fairly contrarian tone, but still giving a solid argument for why criticism is important and how it can add to our experience of literature more broadly. And the final book for this treatment prompt is A Splendid Intelligence, The Life of Elizabeth Hardwick by Cathy Curtis, forthcoming on November 16th. This book is a bit different from the others in the category. It's a biography of one of America's greatest cultural critics during the postwar period. She writes about the depiction of women in classic novels, about the civil rights movement, about theater in New York, about her early experiences in Kentucky. Hardwick may be best known for her turbulent marriage to the poet Robert Lowell, turbulent partly because of his bipolar disease and partly because he published excerpts from her private letters without her permission. But this biography is supposed to restore her to a role larger than that, as co-founder of the New York Review of Books, as a friend of other literary women from Mary McCarthy to Adrienne Rich and Susan Sontag, and of course as critic. This biography sounds amazing. All right, on to the last prompt, industry. Again, I'll name three books for this category. The first is Book Wars, The Digital Revolution in Publishing by John B. Thompson, published in April of this past year, I think. The book tracks how the major technological changes that affected the publishing industry changed the business of bookselling. In addition to the increasing popularity of ebooks and audiobooks, there is the explosion of self-published books. Book Wars is interested in how these developments were both expressions of creativity and real disruptions to the publishing industry. And that is all before the supply chain crisis hit publishers more recently. Interestingly, Thompson wrote a book a decade ago about how the technology of the previous years had changed the direction of publishing. But I think it might be fascinating to see what he actually predicted and what he actually saw happening later. The discussion of how technology affects publishing has been hashed out a bit in public venues for almost two decades, and I'm hoping that Book Wars will offer a sophisticated take on it rather than just the knee-jerk negativity we often see. I've heard that it does offer more than that. A book whose premise interests me even more is the forthcoming Everything and Less, the novel in the age of Amazon by Mark McGirl, due to be published on November 16th. McGirl is interested in how what he calls the platform capitalism of Amazon shapes not just how publishers distribute their wares, but how it influences how we think about books and how we decide what to read. He argues that the algorithm that underlies the "if you like this, you might also like" has changed the whole universe of fiction. So books that have won major literary prizes are put up against fan fiction or self-published romance, etc., exploding the world of strict divisions between genres, the kind of divisions that you probably experience on the shelves at your local bookstore. McGirl makes it clear that he's not condemning this shift, but cautiously celebrating it, as he says. Mostly he's taking note of this enormous change that moves from distinct genres to specific categories of interest, a change that might potentially chart a new direction for literature. It sounds fascinating. Finally, I want to talk about a third book in this category that doesn't talk explicitly about how technology has changed publishing or reading, but I think fundamentally is addressing exactly that. The book is Around the World in 80 Days by David Damrosch, forthcoming on November 16th. Inspired by Jules Verne's Hero, who travels around the globe, Damrosch looks at a wide variety of literature from around the world, books that are in conversation with one another in one way or another. It strikes me that technology has made it much easier for us to communicate across communities and countries and time zones about books. BookTube is, of course, a great example. And it's easier and easier to acquire books published in other countries, too. Dan Rush isn't thinking about how technology has opened his options as much as he does about how the pandemic has closed them. Setting out to counter restrictions on travel, he decides to explore 80 books from around the globe, primarily from authors whose names we probably know from the list of Nobel Prize winners, etc. He's interested both in how these works have shaped our idea of the world and the ways in which the world, as he says, bleeds into literature. It is literary cartography, in his words, and sounds like a terrific celebration of the way literature can expand our vision. Well, all of this planning for Nonfiction November makes me excited for next month, but for now, I'm going to relish the next couple of weeks of Victober. I'm off to read a bit of Trollope right now. Thanks so much for joining me today here on Hannah's Books. See you soon.